Versatility in filmmaking has always been a surefire way to build a successful career. Some who had long-lasting careers in Hollywood utilized this skill to their advantage. One such filmmaker was Billy Wilder. He held titles such as screenwriter, producer, and director, to name a few. In this video, I'm going to take you through some of his most memorable films, as well as the controversy that came his way. As always, please be sure to like, share, and subscribe. Also, hit the bell to stay notified of new content. Please be sure to check out our Patreon page to help us grow the channel. Without further ado, let's take a look at the career of Billy Wilder. Enjoy. Billy Wilder was born Samuel on June 2, 1906, in Austria-Hungary. He was the youngest of two boys. His older brother William Lee would go on to become a filmmaker in his own right, but not with the same success as his younger brother. Samuel would eventually go by the name of Billy, as his mother was a fan of William Buffalo Bill Cody. Billy chose not to enter his family's cake business and instead focused on building a career in writing. He started out writing crime and sports stories for local newspapers before getting a job at a Berlin tabloid. During this time, he became interested in film and focused his efforts on screenwriting. Billy Wilder began this part of his career by collaborating on German films such as The Daredevil Reporter and People on Sunday. His biggest hit at this time was a film adaptation of Eric Kastner's novel, Emile and the Detectives. Wilder would leave Berlin, though, after the rise in power of Adolf Hitler. He moved to Paris, where he made his directorial debut with the film Mauvais Grain. Before the release of this film, however, Wilder would relocate to Hollywood. There, he would find his biggest success. His roommate in Hollywood was none other than actor Peter Lorre, who would go on to have a very successful career. Both had to learn English quickly if they wanted to have any kind of career. Wilder started out writing screenplays for a few films before being paired with fellow screenwriter Charles Brackett. Together, the two would write for many hit films. They first collaborated with director Ernst Lubitsch on the film Bluebeard's Eighth Wife, and then with director Mitchell Leeson on his film Midnight. While both screenplays were well received, the team of Wilder and Brackett would see their biggest success yet when they once again teamed up with Lubitsch by writing the first ever Greta Garbo comedy, Ninotchka. The tagline "Garbo laughs" was a fantastic sales pitch. Garbo was known to be a very serious person, both on and off screen. Very mysterious and virtually untouchable. Wilder and Brackett's script opened new opportunities for one of Hollywood's top actresses. Wilder would also receive his first Academy Award nomination for co-writing Ninotchka. The next hit the duo would write was Howard Hawks' Ball of Fire in 1941. This film starred Gary Cooper and Barbara Stanwyck. What followed this film was one of my personal favorite Billy Wilder films, Double Indemnity. This film reunited Wilder with Barbara Stanwyck and also starred actors Fred McMurray and Edward G. Robinson. This movie is significant for a few reasons. For one thing, Wilder is in the director's chair as well as a co-writer. Two, he co-wrote this not with Charles Brackett, but with screenwriter Raymond Chandler, who wrote the novel The Big Sleep, which would later be adapted by Warner Brothers featuring Lauren Bacall and Humphrey Bogart. The third thing to point out for Double Indemnity is the fact that it is a film noir film. American audiences up to this point knew Wilder for his more comedic style. The film was a huge hit and garnered the director another screenwriting Oscar nomination and a nomination for Best Director. I want to show you all one of my favorite scenes from this film, which features what a great actor Edward G. Robinson was. You're gonna love his slick, smooth talk. Enjoy.
We can go to court and we can prove it was suicide.
Oh, can we? Mr. Norton, first thing that struck me was that suicide angle. Only I dumped it into the waste paper basket just 3 seconds later. You know, you ought to take a look at the statistics on suicide sometime. You might learn a little something about the insurance business.
Mr. Keyes, I was raised in the insurance business.
Yeah, in the front office. Come now, you've never read an actuarial table in your life, have you? Why, we've got 10 volumes on suicide alone. Suicide by race, by color, by occupation, by sex, by seasons of the year, by time of day. Suicide, how committed? By poisons, by firearms, by drowning, by leaps. Suicide by poison, subdivided by types of poison, such as corrosive, irritant, systemic, gaseous, narcotic, alkaloid, protein, and so forth. Suicide by leaps, subdivided by leaps from high places, under the wheels of trains, under the wheels of trucks, under the feet of horses, from steamboats. But Mr. Norton, of all the cases on record, there's not one single case of suicide by leap from the rear end of a moving train. And you know how fast that train was going at the point where the body was found? 15 miles an hour. Now, how can anybody jump off a slow-moving train like that with any kind of expectation that he would kill himself? No, no soap, Mr. Norton. We're sunk, and we'll have to pay through the nose, and you know it. May I have this? Come on, Walter. Next time, I'll rent a tuxedo.
I do have to point out that during the early 1940s, Billy Wilder's mother, grandmother, and stepfather all died during the Holocaust. His mother, Eugenia, was murdered in 1943 in Plaszow. His stepfather, Bernard, was murdered in 1942 at Belzec. And his grandmother, Balbina, died in 1943 in Neue Targ. I can't imagine what was going through Wilder's mind. This may have been what motivated him to make the documentary Death Mills. His intention with this film was to educate German audiences about the atrocities committed by the Nazi regime. Death Mills was released in 1945, the same year that World War II ended, and also the same year that the concentration camps were being liberated. Billy Wilder reunited with Charles Bracken in 1945 to write the screenplay for the film The Lost Weekend, which Wilder would also direct. This film depicted the topic of alcoholism, which was a subject the production code was uneasy about allowing on screen. The production code for years had restricted a lot of what films can show. For example, a married couple had to be seen with separate beds, kisses can only be closed mouth and for several seconds at most. Finally, and this is probably one of the most ridiculous rules, you couldn't show a toilet on screen. Let that sink in for a moment. Now that you've done that, I can leave this on a happier note. The Last Weekend earned Wilder and Brackett the Academy Award for Best Screenplay, and Wilder himself would receive the Best Directing Oscar. Arguably the biggest film Billy Wilder ever directed was the 1950 film noir classic Sunset Boulevard. This film told the story about a young writer named Joe Gillis, played by William Holden, who, while escaping two guys trying to repossess his car, drives onto the property of silent movie actress Norma Desmond, played brilliantly by silent star Gloria Swanson. By Norma's side is her faithful butler Max, played by silent director Eric von Stroheim. Billy Wilder, once again teaming with Charles Bracken, was now tackling something even more taboo than alcoholism in Hollywood. And that's how Hollywood itself shunned silent stars who could not make a successful transition to sound. I want to show you a scene from this great movie. Now, I had a hard time figuring out which clip to show you since there are so many great ones, with just as many memorable quotes. Ultimately, I've chosen the end scene where Norma Desmond has fully succumbed to her broken psyche after murdering Joe Gillis. She believes that she is rehearsing a scene with Cecil B. DeMille, and it is just as impactful now as it was then. Enjoy.
This is the staircase of the palace.
Oh, yes. Yes. Down below, they're waiting for the princess. I'm ready.
All right. Cameras. Action!
So they were turning after all. Those cameras. life, which can be strangely merciful, had taken pity on Norma Desmond. The dream she had clung to so desperately had enfolded her.
Go on with the scene. I'm too happy. Mr. DeMille, do you mind if I say a few words? Thank you. I just want to tell you all how happy I am to be back in the studio, making a picture again. You don't know how much I've missed all of you. And I promise you I'll never desert you again. Because after Salome, we'll make another picture and another picture. You see, this is my life. It always will be. There's nothing else. Just us. And the cameras. And those wonderful people out there in the dark. All right, Mr. DeMille, I'm ready for my close-up.
Now, as you can imagine, Sunset Boulevard angered some in Hollywood. The most shocking criticism came from MGM executive Louis B. Mayer. After the film was previewed, Mayer yelled at Wilder in front of everyone saying, "You have disgraced the industry that made and fed you. You should be tarred and feathered and run out of Hollywood." While this sounds bad enough, Mayer also shockingly told Wilder that he would have been better off sent back to Germany. Given that both men were Jewish, and even more so that Wilder lost his mother, grandmother, and stepfather during the Holocaust, Billy Wilder shot back with a vulgarity that no one had ever heard from him, probably least of all Mayer. Sunset Boulevard would be the last film that Wilder and Brackett would work on together and amicably split in 1950. Wilder continued to direct and write hit films such as Stalag 17, Witness for the prosecution.
The most electrifying entertainment of our time. The stunning climax to a half century of motion picture suspense. The setting is London. The story, two people in love. A murder and a trial, climaxed by the 10 most breath-stopping minutes you've ever lived. The cast, Tyrone Power, in love with a woman who holds his life in her beautiful hands. Charles Laughton, in the most scintillating role of his brilliant career. Marlena Dietrich, the woman of mystery, a fascinating question mark.
Mrs. Vole, do you love your husband?
After these films, he decided to go back to his comedy roots. He initially rejected directing a Laurel and Hardy film, and was in talks with Groucho Marx to direct a new Marx Brothers film entitled A Day at the UN, but it was abandoned after Chico Marx died in 1961. Throughout the 1950s, Wilder primarily made comedies such as The 7-Year Itch.
Didn't you just love the picture? I did, but I just felt so sorry for the creature at the end.
Sorry for the creature? Why'd you want him to marry the girl?
He was kind of scary looking, but he wasn't really all bad. I think he just craved a little affection, you know, a sense of being loved and needed and wanted.
That's a very interesting point of view.
Oh, do you feel the breeze from the subway? Isn't it delicious?
Sort of cools the ankles, doesn't it?
The apartment? Sabrina?
There's no doubt about it, they're having a ball, and you're all invited. Humphrey Bogart and William Holden as the two wealthiest brothers in America, and captivating Audrey Hepburn as Sabrina, the chauffeur's daughter, who ran away to Paris to learn about life and came back home to live it in a great big way.
It's Sabrina. Isn't it amazing? Would you have recognized her? How do you like those legs now?
David.
Aren't they something?
David, the last pair of legs that was something cost the family $25,000.
And Some Like It Hot. Some Like It Hot was actually released without the production code's seal of approval. This did not stop the film from being a hit and becoming one of Marilyn Monroe's most recognizable movies. Apartment made Billy Wilder the first person to win the Oscars for producer, screenwriter, and director all for the same film. Following this, his career began to slow down, and his films were not doing so well. He felt that he was being discriminated against because of his age when the studios virtually stopped hiring him. It's a shame that such an incredible filmmaker with 6 Oscars could no longer find work. There are a couple of silver linings to this, however. For one thing, composer and impresario Andrew Lloyd Webber made a musical version of Sunset Boulevard that was a hit, garnering 7 Tony Awards. Billy Wilder was also presented with the Irving G. Thalberg Memorial Award, an honorary Academy Award that's given to producers who've consistently had a successful body of work throughout their careers. This man's career was one of a kind, to say the least, and he helped create characters and stories that stand the test of time and continue to entertain each new generation of moviegoers. I hope you all enjoyed this video, and thank you so much for watching. I want to remind everyone that if you liked the video, please be sure to like, share, and subscribe. Also, remember to hit the notification bell and check out our Patreon page to help whenever you can. For my partner Joe Lewis and I, we want to thank you again for watching, and we'll see you all again in the next video. Take care.